you, George.
Yes, go back to sleep, old girl.
What time is it?
Rather late, I'm afraid. Sorry I disturbed you.
I don't mind. Was it successful?
I believe so. Decent chap, Laidlaw. Inclined to spin a few yarns about his share of the market, but a realist when it comes to investment. My collar's too tight, Maria.
You're fatter than you used to be. All these restaurant meals late into the evening. Fat doesn't get the chance to disperse.
Damned repulsive observation.
Can't be good for you. Where did you take him?
A little place in... Where was it? Anyway, nowhere special.
And did poor young Nancy go along too, to make notes?
Don't be silly, Maria.
Well, did you?
Yes, why not?
You could be accused of overworking that girl. Doesn't it ever occur to you that she might have alternative ways of filling her evenings?
Well, that's the point. She hasn't. Week in, week out, she has no pleasures, no treats. I doubt if she gets a square meal left to herself. She's showing a keen interest in the business. Heart and soul in it, in fact. And why? Because she knows now she has a chance of entering a different world. Silver cutlery, waiters, dancing attendants holding a shabby coat for her.
Nowhere special, you said. This restaurant where you took Mr. Laidlaw. If that isn't special, let me know when you find a place that is.
Must you be so disagreeable? It's too late.
All right. It's too late. Losing you to the golf club is hard enough now.
Hard? What do you know of hardship? I've made myself responsible for your comfort and well-being, and after years of struggle, you're well provided for.
I struggled too.
Yet you do nothing but criticize and complain and become unreasonably jealous. You've got a lovely home, and yet you're jealous of a young woman who lives in mean, drab rooms with a scoundrel of a brother.
How do you know?
Know what?
Where she lives. Have you been there? Inside?
Oh, it's the area. They're all like that.
Have you been there?
Why, you took her home in a taxi once or twice.
Inside?
Why, of course not.
Then how do you know it's true?
She said so. Maria, the poor girl has an awful life. She's come to think of me as a friend who listens to her troubles and helps where I can.
Humbug!
That'll do, Maria.
We were poor once. Our home was never drab. We distempered the ceilings and painted the walls. We made it seem bright. She could do the same if she tried and paid less attention to painting her face.
That'll do, Maria. I must catch the 8:45.
Taxis.
What?
Taxis. We never take taxis unless we have luggage to carry. It's not worth the expense. What has come over you?
You are being regrettably awkward, Maria. I must go. Maria, Nancy is a sweet girl, and it does a fellow good to see the way she comes alive after a simple gesture of friendliness. But that's all. No real harm in it, I do assure you. It's just that when one is happy oneself, one can afford to be generous to others. A great thing is to be happy.
Humbug!
Edna, damnation, can nobody leave a hat alone in this place?
Are you happy? If not, consult Mr. Barker Pine, 17 Richmond Street.
Shall I clean there?
You can do what you like, Edna. I'm going out.
Mm-hmm. Chilly morning, sir.
Yes, indeed. Miss Purvis not in yet. I dare say she's having trouble with her tram.
Good morning, Miss Draper.
Good afternoon, Nancy.
Oh, Miss Draper, you are a one for old jokes. Am I late?
By 15 minutes. Mr. Packington's here already.
Oh! Well, that's all right, then.
You came in answer to my advertisement.
Yes.
And you're not happy. But very few people are. You'd be surprised if you knew how few people are happy.
Indeed.
Not interesting to you, I know, but interesting to me. You see, for 35 years of my life, I've been engaged in the compiling of statistics in a government office. 35 years, Mrs. Packington. Now I'm retired, and it has occurred to me to use the experience I've gained in a novel fashion. It's all so simple. Unhappiness can be classified under 5 main headings.
Only 5?
No more, I assure you. Ah, tea. And ratafia biscuits.
Oh, my favourites.
Of course. Unhappiness is a malady, and once we know the cause of a malady, the remedy should not be impossible. You see, my dear lady, I stand in the place of a doctor. Isn't that so, Miss Lemon?
Yes, just as a doctor first diagnoses a patient's disorder, then proceeds to recommend a course of treatment.
Of course, there are cases where no treatment can be of any avail. If this is so, I say, frankly, I can do nothing. But if I undertake a case, Mrs. Packington, the cure is practically guaranteed.
Yes, I don't think it's very likely that... On the other hand, I have been so very unhappy lately that it seemed a pity not to. I couldn't help wondering...
Shall we diagnose your case? Now, the trouble concerns your husband. You've had, on the whole, I think, a happy married life. Your husband has, I think, prospered. And I think there's a young lady concerned in the case.
But how...
Perhaps a young lady in your husband's office.
How do you know all this?
Statistics.
Life can seldom offer me any surprises.
Apart from small elements, which, again, can be statistically projected.
Oh.
Tell me, how is he making you unhappy? Oh, you can speak freely in front of Miss Lemon. She's utterly to be trusted.
I'm sure. Well, it's this girl. He pays her such attention. He takes her on the river. Well, I'm fond of going on the river myself. And I like going to the theatre, but George has always said that he was too tired to go out at night. Only now he takes her out to dance. Dancing, and comes home at 3 in the morning.
3 in the morning?
I've always been a good wife to George. His clothes are always mended. He gets good meals, and the house is economically run.
No extravagance, nothing wasted.
Exactly. And I've never even looked at another man.
Of course not.
And now, when we've got on in the world and could enjoy ourselves and get about a bit, do all those things that I've always looked forward to doing, well...
I assure you, I understand your case perfectly.
Can you do anything about it?
Certainly, my dear lady, there is a cure. Oh, yes, there is a cure.
What is it?
You will place yourself in my hands and the fee will be 200 guineas.
200 guineas?
But you can afford to pay such a fee, Mrs. Packington.
£210?
You'll pay as much for an operation. And happiness is just as important as bodily health.
I pay you afterwards, of course.
On the contrary, you pay me in advance.
No, I'm sorry. I don't quite see my way to...
To buying a pig in a poke. Well, perhaps you're right. It is a lot of money to risk. But you see, you've got to trust me. You've got to pay the money and take a chance. Those are my terms.
200 guineas?
It is a lot of money. Good morning, Mrs. Packington. Let me know if you change your mind.
Yes, I don't think that's very likely.
No.
Forgive me for taking up so much of your time. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Mrs. Packington. Goodbye, Alice.
Thank you for the tea.
Pleasure. A new client?
A new client.
Schedule A?
Schedule A, of course. Now, interesting how everyone thinks his or her own case to be unique. Well, well. Now, warn Claude. At least an hour's briefing tomorrow morning at Moroni's, and tell him not too exotic, no scent, and he'd better get his hair cut short.
Shall I make our usual appointments for Mrs. Packington?
Oh, yes, why not? For the moment, she's jibbing, but she'll be back. This afternoon, probably. About 4.
So, somehow I shall have to find £5 for a carpenter. It was a rotten old door in any case. But you'd not think so to hear our landlord carrying on.
But if it was your brother who did the damage...
Oh, poor Eric. He still has his debt to the bank and no job. No. It was my fault for being out so late. He wouldn't have used his penknife on the latch if I'd been at home to let him in. But there. I had a wonderful time, thanks to you, Mr. Packington. I shan't let a broken door spoil the memory. I'm just a bit nervous, that's all.
Nervous?
Till I can afford a new one. You know, in case some crank comes walking in while I'm there alone and no lock to prevent him.
Yes, of course. Nancy, tell your brother to get a really good carpenter.
£10?
Well, my dear child, it is my responsibility. After all, you must see that. It would never have happened if I'd got you home earlier.
No, I oughtn't.
I had to think about it, duty. I don't approve of gambling, but I've never been afraid of making sensible investments. I needed a while to decide what value to place on my chances of being happy.
And you're not placing a bet on an outsider, Mrs. Packington, but looking forward to reaping a good dividend. Thank you. I'm honored by your confidence. A client who cannot trust me is unlikely to benefit from treatment.
And now?
And now you will return home.
Home?
You have no important engagements tomorrow.
No, it's the day we clean the brasses.
Good. Will you make out a receipt for Mrs. Packington, please, and take a note of her address, and then order a taxi for her journey home?
Taxi? Oh, no, I never bother with taxis.
Unless it's raining or you have luggage to carry, it's not worth the expense, I know. But circumstances change. First post tomorrow morning, you will receive certain instructions, which I will be glad if you will carry out.
Oh, this is for you, old dear.
Oh. Thank you, George. An invitation.
This is for you as well.
Oh. Thank you, George.
Well, it's better be off, old dear. Mariah... I may, it's just possible that I may be out to dinner again this evening.
What did you say?
I said I may be out to dinner. I have to see a man on business, so... If by any chance... Edna, good morning to you.
Should I vacuum this morning after I've cleared Mrs. Packington?
You can vacuum and dust and clean the brasses. But first, would you telephone for a taxi?
A taxi?
Yes, I have an extremely full morning ahead. And I shall be lunching out.
Well, what am I going to do with the remains of last night's beef?
Throw it away.
Buttonhole?
For you, Miss Lemon. A late flowering rose, not yet in full bloom. Let us cherish it before the frost nips it in the bud.
Claude telephoned. He wants to know which tie.
Plain silk, dark. Exclusive clubs and public schools mean nothing to Mrs. Packington.
Quite.
Oh, and tell him no overcoat. She'll take it upon herself to advise him to wrap up warmly. You know, in their time, I believe that both Mr. and Mrs. Packington have experienced what it's like to be cold.
A chill? We can't have that.
I felt simply awful when I woke up this morning. I had to drag myself here. I didn't want to let you down, Mr. Packington.
Poor child, you look starved through.
Now, Nancy, permit me to mention it, but your coat, it's thin. It's terribly thin.
It is my best coat, Mr. Packington. I'm saving up, but I can't afford a new one this winter.
Now I've offended you.
Oh, no.
Good. Now, I want no nonsense about this.
Oh, but Mr. Packington, I couldn't
no,
possibly...
No silly pride.
Oh, thank you very much, Mr. Packington.
This may not be altogether pleasant, madam, but we need a firm jawline, don't we?
Actually, it's quite relaxing.
Well, then we can let our eyelids close ever so gently, because we shall have to spend 10 minutes on our fine crow's feet.
The steam was relaxing.
And how it opened our pores, madam. How it opened our pores. Such neglect. This should have been taken in hand years ago. However, it's not too late. These little frown lines. Just a modicum of attention once a fortnight, and we must never allow ourselves to frown.
You see, I knit a lot.
Good. Punctual to the minute. Well done, my dear fellow. Appearance excellent, except for, what is it? Oh, the centre parting, you know, that's a style guaranteed to unnerve the tourists.
I've time to change it.
Oh, yes, indeed, although I have an extensive amount of data for you to absorb and use with your customary skill. Come and have a drink. Our subject may well be late. She has much to occupy her this morning. Two pinchins, please. Now, with this client, you could start with hardship. You know, a sad childhood, maybe. Draw her out toward... She was extensively concerned with her husband's business once, but now she remains at home, harassed by a servant she doesn't need. Oh, for the first time in her life, thank you, Maria Packington has the leisure for a little frivolity.
This isn't a typical Schedule A, is it?
My dear Claude, it's a perfect example.
Oh. Cheers.
There, madam, almost ready. No need to worry. Our receptionist has ordered a taxi to whisk you to Elysee Modes. But when dear Miss Lemon makes appointments for her friends, they always go on from here to Elysee Modes, Monsieur Maurice. I trust Madame wouldn't dream of patronizing anyone else.
Well, actually,
of course not, Madame. Monsieur Maurice has infallible instinct. A titled lady, known to us, had always worn bright green, hadn't she, until she put herself into his care. Imagine a lifetime of slavery to the notion that one could ever appear in public dressed as a lettuce. Now, madam.
Oh.
I'm delighted to see you, as would be every man of good taste. You look charming.
Thank you.
And how do you feel?
Different.
Come and sit down. I venture to order you a white lady. Well, well, well. Now, listen carefully to me, my dear. I've given your case considerable thought, and I have decided that your husband must be made to sit up. You understand? To sit up. Now, to bring this about, I am going to introduce you to a young friend of mine. You will take luncheon with him today.
Not with you? Oh, what about your friend? I mean, won't he mind? I mean, I wouldn't mind.
Shall we... Shall we drink to your health and happiness?
One being as important as the other. I'm not used to cocktails. I'm not used to any of this.
Trust me. Claude. Mrs. Packington, allow me to present Mr. Luttrell.
Delighted to meet you.
But there's no food in Europe to compare with an English Sunday dinner cooked at home by a woman who cares.
You must miss the sunshine, Mr. Luttrell.
Oh, not really. There's more romance in an English autumn, wouldn't you say?
I expect it's very nice in the south of France, though.
Well, yes. But the sight of trees in a London square, their leaves turning bronze, drifting down, rustling along the pavements, and that hint of mist in the morning, I wouldn't exchange that for all the delights of the Riviera.
Mm. I know what you mean. I used to work for George when he started in business, just clerking, typing, answering the telephone, that sort of thing, nothing important. But we had a flat in Muswell Hill then, and we used to walk to the tube through Highgate Woods every morning. And there were squirrels in the trees. Always squirrels playing. It was a good beginning to the day.
Did you enjoy being a businesswoman?
Well, I seem to have had a head for figures. I suppose it's rather like working out knitting patterns. I like doing that. The more complicated, the better. Yes, I enjoyed it. It was hard work there and not very successful at first. I'd send out hundreds of letters and price lists without much response. And then a few orders would come in and then some more. And in the end, it was a treat to see George's face when we opened the post in the mornings. We're in Bakelite, you know.
Ah, Bakelite.
Mm. Mainly domestic goods. No more, Mr. Luttrell, thank you. And then we moved into a bigger house and George felt that, well, it wasn't quite right for a man in his position to have a wife at work, and so...
So now you're free to enjoy yourself.
Yes, I suppose I am.
Splendid. Are you fond of dancing?
I used to be.
Do you know the Aphrodite?
No, we seldom go out anywhere nowadays. My husband doesn't care to go out in the evenings.
Then I must take you there.
Oh, don't be absurd, Mr. Luttrell.
Mr. Packington couldn't be so unkind as to keep you at home. Well, you must tell him. Women don't tolerate male jealousy these days.
Jealousy doesn't... What?
The Aphrodite. There's a marvelous dance band. When should we go?
Is it a nightclub?
One of the best. Tomorrow?
Well, my husband may not... Very well, Mr. Luttrell. Tomorrow...
Mariah, George, it's just possible that I may...
I'm sorry, dear. You were going to say...
No, after you, old dear.
Well, I was just wondering about your evening arrangements. I know you'll think it's ridiculous, but I wondered if you'd mind.
Yes, I do. I do mind, Mariah. If a wife has nothing better to do than keep checking up on a fella, then I suggest she takes up a useful hobby.
George!
Keep her thoughts occupied and put a stop to these damnable suspicions.
Very well, George, I shall take up a hobby.
Good.
Your mail, sir.
Hmm?
No. And a young man brought this for you. Miss Purvis's brother, he said.
Hmm? Poor Miss Purvis. A shocking cold. I saw this coming on, Miss Draper. We've been overworking the poor girl. Do you think perhaps a few dozen roses?
£10 for a carpenter, £15 for a new coat. That makes £25 in 3 days.
What shall we do with it, Eric?
There's a very classy Gigi running in the 2:30 at York on Saturday. What you got in mind for next week?
Oh, I thought perhaps, burst pipes.
Who's a clever girl then?
Oh, Eric.
Packington, you are without doubt the best dancing partner I've ever met.
Mr. Luttrell, you are without doubt the most outrageous flatterer I've ever met.
I mean it.
I'm no expert. I'm simply following you.
How charming you look. That really is a most attractive gown.
Yes, isn't it? This morning it simply arrived on approval.
We approve.
We do. Although I doubt if my husband will when he sees the bill. Mr. Luttrell, you're being very kind to me. I know Mr. Parker Pine must have arranged it, but thank you.
The pleasure's all mine, Mrs. Packington.
You know such exciting people and places. I'm just a little afraid I shall bore you.
Nonsense.
But society ladies
are spoiled children and easily bored themselves, and therefore utterly boring company. You revel in the least novelty. You have a vast capacity for enjoyment. I find it enchanting. Shall we dance?
I know why I've waited. I know why I've been blue. Prayed each night for someone exactly like you. Why should we spend money on a show or two? No one does those exactly like you. Make me feel so grand. I want to hand the scheming, dream I'm dreaming. Now I know why mother taught me to be true. She meant me for someone exactly like
Did you, Mariah?
Yes, dear. Go back to sleep.
What time is it?
Quite late, I'm afraid. Sorry I disturbed you.
Where have you been?
You told me to take up a hobby, George.
Yes.
Mrs. Packington, she says as I shall have her breakfast in bed on a tray this morning, sir. What with her deciding on a lie-in, like a proper respectable lady in a book.
Oh, yes. I think my own capacity for enjoyment was well and truly thrashed out of me at public school.
What was your mother thinking of to have allowed it?
Of my father and his ambitions, I suspect. In my experience, too many women tend to devote themselves to their husband's aggrandizement. Exclusively. I spent my entire youth looking forward to attaining the age of 21 and taking control of my own destiny and fortune.
What a sad waste.
Yes. Because before I reached independence, my family had been ruined and my expectations reduced to nothing. The war began it, you know.
Yes.
All our horses were requisitioned, the house, everything.
Yes, it was a terrible time. I was anxious for George.
So my father sold up for a pittance and took us all to the Riviera. The rest of our fortune was lost on the gambling tables. For 10 years now, I've drifted along on the patronage of sympathetic old acquaintance. It's wearing pretty thin. I can tell you, Mrs. Packington, strictly entre nous, I've often felt so despondent I've thought of ending it all.
Oh, no. No, you must never think like that.
But now, meeting someone so eager to enjoy life, well, you make me ashamed of the notion.
I should think so, indeed.
This report is all very well, Claude, but we did expect it first thing, and it is now nearly 5 to 11. He overslept.
Nosh, typical.
What? If you think it's an appropriate moment, a small tribute, nothing too absurd, then let us know your plans. Good luck.
Really, Miss Lemon, what has luck to do with anything?
They have been lucky with the weather.
Any caprice is capable of being turned to advantage.
It's easier to prolong a luncheon engagement on a fine afternoon. Hmm? Yesterday, the lady expressed a desire to go to Kew.
Kew Gardens? And an art gallery. Hmm? Dancing until the small hours. No wonder he overslept. Does it occur to you, Miss Lemon, that Claude seems to be bringing total concentration to this assignment?
I think he's enjoying it.
Yes, this ought to occur to me. Boom, boom, ba-dum,
ba-dum. Maria.
Hello, Claude. Goodness, your hands are cold. Sit down. I've ordered some tea.
Lovely.
Did you come without an overcoat?
It seemed a bright afternoon. It always does when I'm meeting you.
Charming compliment, but not worth catching cold for.
Oh, a small tribute. Gilding the lily, of course.
In my case, I think it's more like gilding the gingerbread, but let that pass. Oh, how pretty. I haven't a brooch or anything.
Oh, I say, do you think you could possibly find the lady a pin?
A pin? Yes, sir. I expect so.
I must knit you a warm pullover. What's your favorite color?
The color of your eyes.
Sort of nondescript buff, then.
Mariah, you are a joy.
Because I laugh at myself. Don't you think I'm wise too? The joke being that here am I, a middle-aged woman, having afternoon tea with a most agreeable and attractive young man. You don't ever... You wouldn't ever laugh at me behind my back, would you?
Mariah.
It's all right. Claude, I've been thinking.
What?
You don't seem to have a very high opinion of society, ladies, but there are other kinds of girls, you know, warm, affectionate girls. You might find one who wouldn't break your heart.
I rather thought I'd found her, Mariah.
Oh, no.
Where should we go this evening?
Wherever you like.
The Aphrodite.
You're only saying that because you know I love it.
No. No, it's selfishness, really. I want what makes you happy.
The lady's pin, sir.
Oh,
what service!
Wonderfully, wonderfully.
Magnificent.
Absurd.
Thank you.
Could I speak to Mr. Claude Luttrell, please?
Hello? Does it have to be tonight?
Mr. Parker Pine's sense of timing is impeccable.
Damn him. All right, the Aphrodite.
The Aphrodite.
Oh, how very convenient.
Shall I get the manager?
If you would be so kind.
Claude doesn't sound at all happy. Do you think he could be trying to spin this one out?
Well, that would be creating a precedent.
Precedents do occur. Mr. Cornelius, please.
And it's very annoying when they do.
Mr. Parker
Pine.
The whole
statistical basis has to be recalculated. Let's hope you're being unduly pessimistic, Miss Lemon.
I have Mr. Parker Pine for you.
Who?
Mr. Cornelius.
Ah, Corny. Yes. All well? Good. Look, I think it's time for a membership drive. Yes, one of your special cards. Delivered by hand this afternoon to Mr. George Packington and guest. Packington Products Limited, King George V Estate, Neasden...
2 peas in a pod, Nancy. Are you sure you should be back at work?
I couldn't stay away any longer, Mr. Packington.
Well, we must do something about getting the roses back into those pretty cheeks. Cheer you up. Do you think you could enjoy the company of an old buffer again this evening?
Expect so. Oh, I mean, I've told you, Mr. Packington. You don't seem a bit old to me.
Then here is a heaven-sent opportunity. It arrived this afternoon, the Aphrodite. Some nightclub looking for new members. Mr. George Packington and guest.
How did they get your name?
Well, he's known, you know, Nancy. Sounds rather jolly. You won't have been anywhere like it, I'll be bound. What do you say?
No. I'm sure it's much too smart for me, Mr. Packington. Why, I haven't a dress fit to wear.
Parker Pine, offering his services to people like myself. People browsing through the agony column to pass the time. People desperate enough to try to buy a chance of happiness. Is he a charlatan or just a magician?
Does it matter if he's been instrumental in making you happy?
Statistics can't provide a perfect answer every time.
No. Shall we dance again?
Yes.
We've played the game of stay away, but it costs more than I can pay. Without you, I can't make my way. I surrender, dear. When stars appear and shadows fall, why then you'll hear my poor heart call. You, my love, my life, my all, I surrender, dear.
Ah, you're back.
Yes, I'm back.
Rather odd, meeting you.
Yes, wasn't it?
I thought it would be a kindness to take that girl somewhere. She's been having a bad time at home, and I thought, well, your kindness, you know. Who's that chap you were with? I haven't met him, have I?
Luttrell, his name is. Claude Luttrell.
How'd you come across him?
Someone introduced me.
Rather an odd thing for you to do, wasn't it? Go out dancing at your time of life. Mustn't make a fool of yourself, old dear.
A change is always nice.
Yes, but you must be careful. A lot of these lounge lizard fellows going around, you know, and middle-aged women do sometimes make awful fools of themselves. Just warning you, my dear. Wouldn't like you to do anything unsuitable.
I find the exercise beneficial. Expect you do, too. Great thing is to be happy, isn't it? I remember you saying so one morning at breakfast, about 10 days ago.
Yes.
Schedule A, final phase, final briefing, Miss Lemon. Claude has accomplished another successful assignment.
Her husband has seen them together?
Yes, and will have warned her against him.
Splendid. I wonder what your little present will be this time, Claude.
Well, when she meets him at luncheon today, a gold watch in all probability.
Oh, no, too formal. A gold cigarette case, perhaps.
And, Claude, at luncheon, I think, would be the moment for you to renounce your way of life.
So soon?
About 3, shall we say.
For me?
Yes. I hope you like it.
Why'd you give me this? I won't take it. Take it back.
But
take it back, I say.
I'm sorry.
You think I'm just a gigolo, don't you? A creature who lives on women, a lounge lizard. You do, don't you?
I've said I'm sorry. It was tactless.
Well, so you should think that of me. It's true. Oh, yes, I had my orders to take you about, to amuse you, to make love to you, make you forget your husband.
Claude, I guessed, and it doesn't matter.
But that was my job, Mariah. A despicable one, eh?
Why are you telling me all this?
Because I'm through with it. I can't carry on like this, not with you. You're different, Mariah. You're the kind of woman I could believe, trust, adore. Oh, I know you think it's all part of the game. Well, it isn't, and I'll prove it. I'll have to go away because of you. I'm going to turn myself into a man because of you instead of the loathsome creature that I've become.
Go away? Is that necessary?
It's the only way. I've been a rotter, always. But I swear to make good from now on. You read the agony column, don't you? Well, on this day, every year, you will find a message there.
Oh, Claude, please.
A message saying that I remember you and that I'm making good. Every year, you'll know then all you've meant to me. And one thing more. I've taken nothing from you. I want you to take something from me.
No, I couldn't.
Mariah, shut up, will you? I'm trying to say goodbye. This was my mother's. I'd like you to have it. Goodbye, Mariah.
Look here, Mariah. About that girl.
Yes, dear?
I never meant to upset you, you know, about her. Nothing in it.
I know. I was foolish. See as much of her as you like, if it makes you happy.
Mariah!
Yes, George?
Why, it isn't right for a wife to urge a fellow to take a girl about.
It isn't?
Well, no, it's not decent.
Not so much fun, you mean?
Fun had nothing to do with it.
No, George.
What you don't seem to realise is that it takes it out of a fella, that sort of thing.
What sort of thing, George?
Dancing, that sort of thing.
I must say, dear, you are looking rather tired.
Well, I could do with a holiday. We might go away together somewhere for a break, if you like.
Don't worry about me. I'm quite happy.
Damn it, woman, I'd like to take you somewhere. We might go to the Riviera. What do you say to that, hmm?
Perhaps Torquay.
Papworth, Packford, Packington. There. I'm right in thinking this case is closed.
Assuredly.
What was the entertainments account?
£102.14.6.
Ah. Good morning, Claude. Did everything go off satisfactorily?
Yes, I suppose so.
The ring. What name did you have inscribed in it?
Matilda, 1899.
Excellent. And the wording for the advertisement?
Making good, still remember Claude.
Make a note of that, Miss Lemon. To be inserted in the agony column on, what is it, November the 1st for, let me see the entertainments again. Oh. Yes, 10 years, I think. That'll leave us a profit with £90, and that's adequate.
Mr. Parker Pine, there's something I've got to say.
Yes, Claude?
I don't like any of this. It's a rotten game.
My dear boy. You better come through for a moment. I think we may have a small element of surprise.
It could have been statistically projected.
That was a decent woman, a good sort. Telling her all those lies, filling her up with the usual sob stuff. Well, I've had enough. It makes me sick.
Dear me, I don't recall your conscience ever troubling you before. You've had a splendidly notorious career.
Well, I'm beginning to feel differently about it all. Look, this game, it isn't nice.
Now, look at it this way, Claude. Instead of displaying your usual callous mercenary instinct, you have given an unhappy woman what every woman needs. A romance. A woman tears a passion into pieces and gets no good from it. But a romance. A romance, my dear Claude, can be laid up in lavender and looked at through all the long years to come. I know human nature, my boy, and I tell you that a woman can feed on such an incident for years. Well, I think we can safely say that we have discharged our commission to Mrs. Packington. Very satisfactory.
Well, I don't like it.
Interesting vestiges of conscience, noticeable in hardened lounge lizard. Note. Study developments.